Hi everyone, my name is Theodor Mitev, and in this lecture I want to discuss the phenomenon of the information stack and the emergence of what I describe as feudalism 2.0, which is concurrent with the rise of this vertically integrated information stacks. In this lecture, I will start as usual by retracing my steps a little bit in order to connect to what has been discussed before. So I'll first start with talking about the attention economy, and I'll link this to the phenomenon of feudalism and then to the emergence of what has been described as walled gardens. And following that, I'll discuss stacks and this phenomenon of feudalism 2.0. All right, so let's start with the attention economy and the valorization of user attention in aggregate. So the first step we need to take is to try and remind ourselves what the information slash network society actually stands for. So we have a social structure made of information networks which permeate the social body, so to speak. This is a global environment described as a global bioelectronic environment because it involves a mixture of biological signals and electronic signals, and the immersion of the body in the electronic environment, as it were. The central resource of this network society is knowledge. It's organized around the valorization of knowledge, in this context, actionable knowledge. It is operating on the principle of binary access, so it's inclusion slash exclusion. In the context here of the ability to participate in the routing of information flows or the absence of such an ability, right? So if you're on the network, you're visible, you can participate. If you're not on the network, you literally do not exist. And the strategic space, the operational space, and the tactical space for the network society is in people's minds, right? So because that's where information gets processed by the users participating in this environment. The new economy that emerges with the rise of the network society is obviously and logically organized entirely around knowledge work, around the routing of global information flows. It's characterized by decentralized operations because of the need to lower the transaction costs of the organizations operating according to this new economy. And the primary value here, the primary vector of valorization, is in the connection to and the sorting of information. This in turn necessitates a logic of free information flows, which demands labor, right? Participatory labor, which is always already unrestrained by borders. And by borders here, we understand not only the physical borders between states, but also the conceptual borders separating private time from public time, or work time from leisure time, or family from the outside, etc., etc. And concomitantly with that obliteration of borders, we have the urge to be always available for work, right? So the necessity to be continuously present to route and engage with information flows. So the emergent picture that we mapped already in previous lectures is one of obliteration of individual, family, state, geographical borders, a total homogenization of time and space across the entire bioelectronic environment, right? Which we described as cyberspace line with the cyberpunk trope that emerged in the 1980s. we have the emergence of personal information spaces, which are these mobile computational devices that everyone is carrying, which in turn leads to presence bleed, right? The obliteration of being and being here physically and mentally, and the separation, as it were, between the two, so that, you know, you are nominally here, but you are actually absent, right? You are somewhere else. Your physical presence is bleeding away. This leads to that continuous urge and necessity to sort information, a precarious existence, and an environment characterized by constant flux, after Zygmunt Bauman, right? So this is liquid life. And we also talked about an interesting phenomenon which emerges here in the context of this liquid life, liquid labor environment, which is connected with the kind of the way value is being produced. And what's interesting here is that user participation in these environments leads to a content abundance, because users generate content. And content abundance in turn puts tremendous pressure on platforms to lower storage costs, and lowering storage costs in turn put pressure on further content abundance, right? So there is a closed feedback loop here between user participation and the dramatic increase in the availability of content. So it's an environment of content plenitude, in line very much with Stuart Brand's dictum that information wants to be free. And this relationship has been captured very nicely, described very nicely by Tim O'Reilly when he talks about the appearance of Web 2.0 in the early 2000s. And he talks about value emerging as a side effect of ordinary use of applications, as a side effect of participation, right? So this is a really important moment, and the rest of this lecture is basically exploration and a discussion of this specific insight from Tim O'Reilly, right? The emergence of value, the valorization of the side effects of participation and content creation at scale, right? At scale being a key moment here. So this is an effect that emerges only when content is viewed at a macro level in aggregate. Hence, systems improving the more people use them. So we also talked about this in the previous lecture, about in the context of curation costs, right? So while storage costs are dramatically falling because of user participation and content abundance, you have a completely different relationship when it comes to curation. Why? Because the more content there is floating around the network, the harder it is to find that specific content that is necessary. Remember, the key value here is actionable knowledge. So the harder, the more content there is floating around the network, the harder it is to find actionable content, right? Able to generate knowledge, hence high curation costs. That's where the value proposition is, in the curation of content. And again, this ties up with Stuart Brand's dictum, information wants to be free, but it also wants to be expensive. And so what emerges is a very interesting dynamic, a very interesting relationship between the production of content and user participation and the generation of value as a side effect, right? So mass participation leads to content abundance, leads to amateurization of the aesthetics of production. There is low storage costs emergent as a result of the pressure that is put by mass participation and content abundance. The value proposition shifts to content curation. And the act of participation, the act of paying attention to something or creating a certain type of content, generates value as a side effect, right? So it's not the content itself that provides the value. It is the act of paying attention, right? So there's a very interesting dynamic here. And this is related again to that notion of low storage costs, because low storage costs in practice mean infinite shelf space when it comes to the large aggregator platforms, such as Amazon. So we have infinite shelf space, the ability to extract patterns of behavior from the types of user participation that the platform collects. And this is what real-time information about buying trends stands for in this equation. And then this in turn leads to the ability to generate a very careful and very well curated content suggestions and an insatiable demand for niche content, right? Which is content carefully curated for a specific niche group. And we describe this in the context of the long tail. It's a power law distribution, which emerges axiomatically in any large aggregate of random information, random being key here. And moreover, it emerges axiomatically even in niche markets where you have a niche emerging from a large data set. Automatically, axiomatically, you would have a long tail, a power law distribution emerging. And so this, we mapped it to the ability to choose from within a large amount of possible choices when it comes to content, for example. So the very act of choosing spread widely enough and freely enough when it comes to content, for example, creates a power law distribution. So if you think of, Netflix, right? So the more choices there are on Netflix, the more pronounced the power law distribution would be between the 20% of the most popular choices and the 80% of the choices which form a long tail. So the more difference, the more variety, the more diversity, the more pronounced the power law distribution. So given a random group of people have a complete freedom to choose between a range of diverse options, they will inevitably create a power law distribution. And as Clay Shirky points out, diversity plus freedom of choice creates inequality, and the greater the diversity, the more extreme the inequality. Again, this is in the context of the emergence of power law distributions when it comes to large data sets. Again, this is all about the emergence of these large data aggregates, which generate that value, or the ability to extract value from user participation, and the ability to observe and manipulate the formation of large and very pronounced power law distributions. So again, what happens here is because of the, and we talked about this in the previous lecture, because of the inbuilt natural limitations on human attention, which is a scarce resource, right? It is it's a bottleneck when it comes to the flow of information. The more information there is, the more pronounced the scarcity of attention, right? Because you can only watch so many things at any one time. And this is, again, a hard-coded bottleneck when it comes to the flow of information. So we define the attention economy as characterized by information abundance with a long tail, with a very pronounced power law distribution model. It leads to a scarcity of attention, which in turn generates long tails in each and every content niche. Relationship within the attention economy is a zero-sum game in the context of the fact that, you know, you can only pay attention to this or to that thing, right? So if, let's say, 80% of users pay attention to this specific 20% of content, then there is a zero-sum game when it comes to the 80% of content that is left, right? So this in turn leads to polarization and inequality, and the more pronounced the power law distribution, the larger the data set, right? The more choices are there, the more pronounced the diversity of these choices, the more pronounced the polarization and inequality is going to be, right? So this is axiomatic. We talked about this already. And the way to differentiate oneself when it comes to this sort of pronounced long tails is through creating generative value, through creating something that cannot be easily copied. All right, so far so good. This sets the stage for the material that we will be exploring for the rest of this lecture. And the key aspect here is the scarcity of attention, the ability of platforms, of the data aggregators to extract a value from user participation, from user engagement with content, and the emergence, the inevitable emergence of pronounced power law distributions. All right, now let's take a step back and do a brief journey through time to try and understand the key characteristics of feudalism in order to be able to use this down the track in our analysis and exploration of what is emerging right now. So feudalism is a concept which is usually associated with medieval Europe, and it has a number of different characteristics, and it's a contested term. There are many historians who would argue that it never really existed in the way it is popularly described in the popular historical literature. It is very much a vague term, right? So this is not some sort of scientific term describing a specific historical phenomenon. Moreover, you have to realize that medieval Europe was a civilization. It was very much a civilization which lasted more or less around 1,000 years from the fall of the Roman Empire until the mid of the 15th century, until the fall of Constantinople and the disappearance of the Byzantine Empire. And as such, as a civilization which lasted for 1,000 years, feudalism is a phenomenon that can be described in many different ways because of the vast differences in terms of time, right? So it looked in one way, let's say in the 8th century, in a completely different way in the 14th century, and also in terms of space, because feudalism had certain characteristics in France which it didn't have anywhere else. It had certain characteristics in southern Germany that it didn't have in northern Germany, for example. So it's a patchwork of practices spread over centuries, right? So again, it's a very vague and wide term that is used as a placeholder to describe this tremendously rich and fascinating civilization. But for our purposes, there are certain characteristics that we can sort of generalize from this patchwork of different phenomena. So first, feudalism describes a relationship between a lord and a vassal. So this, the lord can be a very rich baron or marquis, or it can be the lord can be just a very small landholder with a few peasants acting as his vassals, right? So no matter what the financial and economic and political or military stature of the lord, the relationship was always one between lord and vassal, and it was always organized around property and allegiance held, or rather allegiance owed to the lord by the vassal in lieu of the property that was being used by the vassal, right? So property here is the essence of that relationship. And by property, we mean land, right? Land being the scarce resource. So the economy of feudal medieval Europe was based on land. Land formed the key unit of value in that economy, in that society. And most people working the land were free peasants. And by free, we mean that, and I framed it here as nominally free, because, and again, this was there's a vast difference between the economic and social standing of peasants depending on the country and depending on the time period. But nominally, to generalize, they were free. They were not serfs, they were not slaves by any means, right? So they could move around, they could own property, they could make their own economic choices, they owed allegiance to their local feudal lord based on the land that they were working. And The key aspect here for our purposes is the fact that the land was controlled by the feudal lord, right? So even though free peasants would own their own land, and they would be literally the owners of the land, the feudal lord, as the person that the peasants were vassals of, had the final say when it comes to the use of that land, and when it comes to the way that land could be, for example, resold or given to someone else as a loan. And by the way, if you like these illustrations, they come from a famous illustration by the Limburg brothers for the Duc de Berry, and it's a beautiful book with medieval illustrations. So now, when we look at the medieval society, our sort of central concept is the manor, right? So this is the landholding and the center of the feudal lord's power over the land is the medieval manor. And when it comes to the way the relationships were organized, first thing, the peasant, the person who was the vassal of the lord, could not leave the land without permission, right? So they were nominally free, but they could not abandon the land and go somewhere else without the permission of the feudal lord. Moreover, they could not sell the land without permission, even though it was theirs, right, nominally. The feudal lord had the final say over how the land was going to be used. So, for example, would that land be used to graze livestock, or would it be used for the cultivation of specific agricultural commodity? And finally, the peasant, the vassal, had to pay rent to the feudal lord for using the land. And this rent was paid as in lieu of, nowadays we would call it a tax, right? So it would be 10 or 20% more or less in terms of the tax that the peasant, the vassal, was paying to the feudal lord. All right, so what we have emerging from all of this is a set of relationships built around land, which created a scenario where the nominally free peasant, who was nominally the owner of that land, was very much controlled by his or her feudal lord, who was who had the final say over how the land was going to be used. And this is something important that we will return again at the end of this lecture. So please keep this in mind when it comes to feudalism. Now let's jump to again to the present and to the emergence of this phenomenon of walled gardens. Let's try and examine how that works. So again, a reminder what the attention economy is, right? So it's built around information abundance and creates power law distributions. It's a zero-sum game. It involves polarization and inequality and the creation of generative value. So from the perspective of large corporations emerging around that time, around the late 90s, early 2000s, because this is more or less the period where the cutting edge, the bleeding edge of the internet's venture capitalists and developers start asking themselves the question, how to extract surplus value from the emergence of these long tails, how to extract surplus value from this environment of content plenitude and attention scarcity. And their answer is the creation of walled gardens. And we have the emergence, we can see, literally observe step by step the emergence of walled gardens. And the way I've called them is the FANG walled gardens. So this is Facebook, Amazon, Apple, Netflix, Google. You could add other companies as well, but these five companies capture very well the complexity of that term and their practices and the way they've organized themselves demonstrate very well how the walled garden is used to extract value from this environment. So when you are looking at the following slides, you should be thinking continuously about your experiences when dealing with Facebook or Amazon, Apple, Netflix, and Google, because all of them form, in effect, stacked walled gardens. And this kind of builds into where we're going to go next, namely the phenomenon of the stack. So what is so inviting and so interesting about walled gardens? First of all, they're built around content curation. And of course, if you've been paying attention so far, this should be obvious. The primary value proposition when it comes to an environment of information abundance, of content abundance, is content curation, right? Because of the scarcity of attention. So, hence, any walled garden allows you to find the content you like, right? And this ability to find the content you like easily, and it seems so natural, but there is tremendous resources, there's tremendous energy expenditure harnessed in order to allow you, for example, to find the videos you want on YouTube very fast, or to find the movies you want to watch easily on Netflix, right? Out of a catalog of hundreds of thousands of pieces of content, let's say in the context of Netflix, or of billions of pieces of content in the context of Google. So the first characteristic here is curation, right? Finding the content you like easily. Then you have the notion of scale, right? So scale works both in terms of the content that is available and also in terms of the other users who are present, right? So walled gardens always already operate at scale. So they have usually users in the hundreds of millions or billions in the case of Facebook and Apple and Amazon and Google. Then we have this notion of usability, which is the ease with which content finding and usage happens. And this is, again, all because of the walled garden. And finally, safety, obviously, right? So the elimination of extreme content, or the elimination of any possible threats, no undesirables, right? It's a safe environment. So these are the value propositions of the walled garden. But why do I call it a walled garden in the first place? And the key thing to understand here is that this is not the internet anymore, right? So these are spaces which try and seal themselves off from the internet, from the open internet. And the key thing about the walled garden is that there is an effort to control how you use the content. And this control can be several different types. It can be very strict control in terms of copyright and intellectual property, boundaries being firmly established. It can be a soft control in terms of let's call it soft censorship of the type of information that you can post and share and like. Or it can be an even softer type of control in terms of the algorithm making certain undesirable types of content less visible. The key point here is that the walled garden always exercises a level of control over the content, right? It has the final say over the type of content that can appear and or be findable or be visible to everyone operating in the garden, right? And therefore, the fundamental insight here is the content is tied to the garden. And again, this can be tied very firmly, as for example with Netflix or other similar platforms such as Netflix, or not so firmly as, for example, content on closed Facebook groups or content on YouTube, for example. Fundamentally, this content is controlled through licensing fees or through copyright controls. And again, this all leads to the realization that fundamentally, this is not the internet anymore. These are platforms which are operating as parasites over the free flow of information available on the internet. And when you think of that, think of apps on the Apple App Store or on the Google Play Store, and think of the fact that they cannot be indexed by web search engines, right? So their content is invisible to the web search engines, therefore invisible to the larger web. You need to be on those apps. Same thing applies for closed Facebook pages, for example, right? So in the words of John Battelle, the old internet is shrinking and being replaced by walled gardens over which Google's crawlers cannot climb. Sure, Google can crawl Facebook's public pages, but those represent a tiny fraction of the pages on Facebook and are not informed by the crucial signals of identity and relationship which give those pages meaning. Furthermore, when it, again from John Battelle, when Google crawls the public pages of Apple's iTunes store on the web, all the value creation in the mobile iOS app world is behind the walls of Fortress Apple. So Google can't see that information, can't crawl it, and can't make it universally available. So for all intents and purposes, that information is not on the internet, right? It's walled off, hence walled garden. Same thing applies for the Amazon Kindle universe, Microsoft Xbox, etc., etc. So what do we have in effect is we have the walled gardens acting as a large hierarchical closed databases, right? So these are hierarchical, centralized data sets which are crawled over by proprietary algorithms owned by these walled garden platforms. And the role of these algorithms is to extract the value which is generated by users contributing to these centralized databases, right? And the opposite side of this transaction is the control being exercised over that information generated by users from the databases, from the walled gardens, the surveillance of the information flows generated by users, again, surveillance performed by the walled gardens, and the censorship over users in terms of the weeding away of undesirable information from the walled gardens. And this is where it gets interesting, because the key sales points of the walled gardens, right, the FANG walled gardens are the content curation, the availability of content in scale, at scale, and the availability of other users at scale, the usability of that content, and the safety of the environment, hence walled garden. So these are the sales points, right? But the interesting thing here, in the context of the attention economy and the fact that this is an environment characterized by information abundance and scarcity of attention and power law distributions, and polarization and inequality, is this, again, we are turning to this phenomenon of the extraction of value as a side effect from the data being generated by users. And that value, what is that value, right? And that value that extracted from the aggregate user data is information about your social circle, information about you, all sorts of patterns identifiable about you as a user, and about the group of users that you could be matched to. So what do you talk about? What kind of, who do you talk to? What do you talk about? What do you pay attention to, right? Again, remember, attention is a scarce resource here. What kind of information do you search for? What other patterns can be inferred from the information that you search for? What are your preferences? What are your likes, your dislikes, etc., etc., etc.? So this is just the very tip of the iceberg of behavioral information that is extracted from this aggregate user data as the side effect of information generation. Again, remember, user participation leading to content abundance, leading to lower storage costs, generating further content abundance. And from the perspective of these large platforms, that create walled gardens, the more they know about you, in terms of the more pattern information is extracted from your information aggregate, the more valuable your data becomes, right? So its value, its valorization vector is informed by the precision with which your further behavior can be predicted, right? By the quality of the patterns that emerge as a side effect from your participation, from your engagement with information. And the more valuable your data is, naturally, the more of it they want to keep. So there is a overwhelming logic of extraction here, right? It's a one-way extraction. So you create content or you engage with content on these walled gardens, in these walled gardens, on these platforms. And from their perspective, this is a one-way relationship, because they are simply extracting, as a side effect of your participation, they're extracting patterns of behavior valorizing those patterns in terms of aggregates. And this in turn brings us now to a discussion of stacks, right? So this is what this lecture is all about. This is our main focus. And it's really important to be able to understand walled gardens as a phenomenon in order to narrow down our understanding of stacks. So what is the stack? Quite simply put, stacks are vertically integrated walled gardens. What do I mean by that? You would have the appearance of walled gardens in the singular, such as let's say Facebook as a walled garden, but then you have the stacking of other applications which add additional sources of information for Facebook. Like, for example, you have Instagram as an added source here, and you have ideally more and more of such stacked walled gardens integrated vertically into one big stack. This stack operates by extracting value from each of the walled gardens it controls. And usually a stack would involve hundreds of millions of users or billions of users. The largest stacks today are Google, Amazon, Facebook, WeChat, Tencent. So these are companies that would own walled gardens, allowing them to pull billion plus people or more than that even, right? So this gives them the opportunity to operate at tremendous scale, right? So they have the ability to aggregate heretofore unthinkable quantities of content and to run their predictive algorithms on that content in order to extract value, right? Again, remember, value is extracted as a side effect of a user participation and content generation. The stack invariably runs on its own proprietary operating system, which may or may not be made public to users to participate on. So for example, it's notice how Google's strategy has been to create its own operating system and give it away for free to users to participate on, therefore allowing Google to leverage all of that to extract extra data. I'm talking here about Android. All that operating system can be proprietary, like in the case of Apple. This proprietary operating system naturally allows the stack to create its own closed environment, right? Which gives it the ability to leverage all content created by users in all the different walled gardens it controls, and to extract the maximum amount of information and patterns of behavior from that content, and to control it better overall. And In order to do that, obviously it has to have its own cloud, its own cloud server farms where all that data, user data is stored, right? Users usually completely ignore the fact that all the information that they upload to the stacks, the information that they think is theirs, actually is stored on server farms controlled by the stack, right? And even if the terms of service nominally declare that that data is controlled by the users, right, and it's still owned by the users, it is fundamentally owned, controlled, and stored on server farms controlled by the stack, right? And the tremendous costs to operate these server farms are offset by the value of the patterns emerging from that data. This has to always be remembered when it comes to the stack. Most of the stacks have their own mobile device ecology, so they would have one or several devices which act as peripherals, allowing to users to interface with the stack. So this is quite visible in the case of Apple and Google and Amazon, for example. They might often have their own currency as well. This currency can be a formal or informal one, allowing further valorization vectors within the stack. And for our intents and purposes, the key realization here is this, that the users who the people who are the active participants in the different walled gardens stacked together, right, controlled by the stack, the people who are contributing content, these are the main production base of the stack. So this is literally the value that is owned by the stack. It's the users. And the way Bruce Sterling frames it quite brutally, but quite truthfully, in my opinion, is that the internet had users, but stacks have livestock, right? So the people who used to be users on the open internet, right? Nodes equal in their power on the network, on that distributed network, in the stack, right? In the context of the stack, these users are not users anymore, right? They are not nodes equal to each other. They are livestock to be milked for value, right? In the context of content here. So again, as the way Bruce Sterling describes it, you are not a node on the internet equal to all other nodes. You are a client working inside a proprietary device, right? So think in terms of Instagram, think in terms of Facebook here, how this shapes up. So the stack knows all about you because of all the data about yourself that you have been feeding it. So the stack extracts all that information to build a very detailed persona, very detailed profile. And you know, if you've been, let's say, on Facebook for a few years, for 7, 8, 9, 10 years maybe, on Facebook or on Instagram for that matter, because Instagram is a walled garden part of the Facebook stack, Facebook knows all about you. It has a data set that goes into the tens of thousands of pages about you. And all of that information, all of these patterns are being monetized continuously to build predictive algorithms, to build predictive profiles and molds of behavior. And fundamentally, you, the former user, are the product of the stack. We, the former users, are the product of the stack. And as Bruce Sterling quite forcefully put it, we are not users anymore, we are livestock when it comes to the stack. As Australian media theorist Mackenzie Work frames it, we pay Google a sort of information tax. If you want some data, you have to give up some about who you are, what you do, what your movements are. Like most other states, Google will then sell access to you to other interested parties. And that access to you is actually the access to that detailed persona extracted from, as a side effect from, the content you've been generating and sharing on Google. And Furthermore, we are not really the citizens of this stack, right? We are its peons. We always all adapt of information to Google, no matter how much of it we have already given up, right? So again, this is not a relationship of some sort of equal partnership between nodes. It's a exploitative, extractive relationship. McKinsey work describes it as us as peons here, right? So we are operating in a vassal state, as it were. And our leisure time is now spent producing information for the what McKinsey work describes as voucher industries of Google and Co. in an unequal exchange of information. Again, so in the process of leisure and entertainment and producing content and sharing content, we are creating this extractive value for the stacks. In exchange for the poll tax of personal data, we get to watch each other's cat videos while Google becomes some new version of the state, presiding over all our BT lives, master of all our data in aggregate. And viewed in at the macro level, what emerges is a phenomenon that Shoshana Zuboff has described as the age of surveillance capitalism. So surveillance capitalism is characterized by this extraction of patterns of behavior, which in turn appear as a function of literally the process of us living our day-to-day lives in the stack, right? So it's an unilateral extraction of human experience as free raw material for translation into behavioral data. Although some of these data apply to service improvement, the rest are declared as a proprietary behavioral surplus fed into advanced manufacturing processes known as machine intelligence and fabricated into prediction products that anticipate what you will do now, soon, and later. So again, here you have a very well formulated snapshot of the modus operandi of the stack. And it's centered around the extraction of behavioral data as the raw material emerging from the human experience of processing information, right? Generating and processing information. And this behavioral data is used to create prediction products that anticipate what we will do now, soon, and later. And these prediction products, as Shoshana Zuboff describes, are traded in a new kind of marketplace that I call behavioral futures markets. Surveillance capitalists have grown immensely wealthy from these trading operations, for many companies are willing to lay bets on our future behavior. And again, what is here, we have it distilled into its very essence, right? What is being extracted as a side effect of user participation. Again, I'm returning here to the description of the attention economy and furthermore of the key process of liquid life, right? Liquid labor and the incessant task of sorting information is this. It is behavioral data which forms predictive patterns that can be traded, companies are willing to lay bets on our future behavior as based on these predictive patterns. So let's reassess what we have emerging so far. What is the picture when it comes to the stack? So we have vertically integrated walled gardens with hundreds of millions or billions of users, having their own proprietary operating systems, with their own cloud server farms, often with their own mobile device ecology, often with their own currency. Fundamentally, and this applies to all stacks, the users are the main product. It's the main product is not the content or service, it is the users. The users provide, through their participation, the raw material for the generation of behavioral data. And this behavioral data in turn is used as a predictive model for future behavior, right? So it allows the prediction of future behavior and the manipulation, therefore, of future behavior in these futures markets. And armed with this understanding, we can now return to our definition of feudalism and try and map the new type of feudalism, feudalism 2.0. So we have an economy which is based on behavioral data. What is traded as the primary resource, as the primary unit of value, is not land, as in feudalism 1.0, but behavioral data, which is extracted from the patterns of participation of hundreds of millions of users. Users are technically speaking free, right? Users are technically speaking free to move between stacks, technically speaking free in terms of owning their content, at least in most cases. But fundamentalist stacks control all aspects of information use. Stacks control all aspects of content use when it comes to the modalities of user behavior. So let's try and describe the manner 2.0, the I manner. First and foremost, content cannot appear on the stack without permission, right? If someone uploads content, say someone uploads content on YouTube that Google does not want to have on YouTube, that content will be removed automatically, right? YouTube also has a variety of filters that can be deployed selectively to filter out undesirable types of content. For example, based on implied copyright infringement, or etc., 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 right? So content cannot appear on the stack without the explicit permission of the stack owner. Furthermore, the stack decides how you use the content. And this can be down to a very fine-grained level of control over what literally you can do with that specific piece of content from moment to moment, or to a very broad level of control, again, depending on the stack and on the specific time period. Furthermore, the stack monetizes your behavior and the content you create, consume, and share, right? So everything you do within the stack is literally labor for the stack. Even if you're thinking you're sharing your own cat videos, what you're actually doing, you're working for the stack, you're creating value for the stack. And the stack monetizes all the entirety of your behavior, both in terms of the productive behavior, in terms of you creating content, but also your second order behavior in terms of you, your attention, the kind of content you share, the kind of content you like, the kind of content you like to watch, etc., etc. And finally, you pay rent for using the stack by giving it ownership of your behavioral data. And this is the key. This is the subservient aspect of the entire relationship, right? Nominally, the stack is free and inviting, right? These are walled gardens that invite you in, but this is a vassal relationship, because what you're giving in return is your behavioral data, which the stack monetizes. So here we have feudalism 2.0. We have total control over the kind of content that appears on the stack, and how that content is used. And we have a monetization of each and every aspect of user behavior, including the aggregate behavioral data and the patterns that emerge that can be leveraged as predictive patterns. And these are the key elements here of that new user platform relationship we're trying to understand. This is, again, feudalism 2.0. Okay, so let's summarize everything we've discussed so far in this lecture. We have the appearance of walled gardens, the FANG walled gardens, as we describe them. That's Facebook, Apple, Amazon, Netflix, Google, as our case studies. The key sales points for the walled gardens are the curation of content, the scale at which they operate, both in terms of content and user base, the usability of the environment, and the safety of the environment, both in terms of content and user base. When you have a number of walled gardens integrated vertically, we have the emergence of the phenomenon of the stack. The stack involves hundreds of millions of users, its own proprietary operating system, its own storage facilities, its own often mobile device, it calls its own currency. Users are its main product. They are the raw material for the generation of behavioral data, which in turn is leveraged to create behavioral futures markets. That is all from me for this lecture in the context of the emergence of Feudalism 2.0. If you have any questions, please hit me up on Twitter at TedMutu. Thank you all for listening and see you online.